Kai Senpai's prediction comes true. He says Sword will win over Vengeance and Aegis wins over all. So
Aegis wins over all. I agree with him with the Sword over the Vengeance Blood. You know, I kind of have to. It makes sense. Mm-hmm. But Aegis wins over all. It'd be tough to see. It'd be tough to see because of the necessary things you have to have. You've got to have the Aegis, or excuse me, you've got to have the Test of Strength on turn 8, and then another follower to kind of turn up maybe an Angel to evolve, heal, and being able to trade and gain tempo that turn as well for Aegis on turn 9. So we'll see if Auto Aim is able to pull off that combo. Meanwhile, this is the first semifinals game of Week 9 of the NGE Shadowverse Open. We've got Mana Surge's Shugo versus Potwasher at Crimson Fencers. Mm.
I like how the name forces you to say it that way. Potwasher at Crimson Fencers.
Yeah. Pretty cool.
Rather than, pretty like, cool. Crimson Fencers, Potwasher.
Right.
Just because he wrote his name the opposite way.
Hmm.
We're just sheep. Literally,
we don't understand
just whatever the
anything.
Teleprompter says.
Wait, we have a teleprompter?
The teleprompter is telling
me to say
this.
I didn't know we had a teleprompter this whole time.
The teleprompter is telling me to say that.
Full disclosure, we do not have a teleprompter.
We do not. That's right. Why we have no idea what we're talking about half the time.
All right, this is... Oh, man, this is... it's a slow game so far. There wasn't a one drop from either player. But Shugo and Potwasher are both sitting on pretty solid two drops. So we're going to be able to see what the tempo is going to be able to look like for both of these players. But the Shadow is going first. Going to have to give that as a huge advantage over to Potwasher.
Mm-hmm. There's a Dark Conjurer without anything to conjure. Mm-hmm. Mentor's Teaching. That was kind of an interesting card to include for Shugo, I believe.
Right,
Mentor's
yeah,
Teaching
sure.
is kind of a... It's plus one only for the turn that you're on right now, so it does not persist. It draws a card. I think it makes sense in terms of aggression and also to even out your curve just a little
right.
bit.
And it fills your hand up back again, so you're not losing a card. You're not losing any momentum there. And it gives you the chance to draw into another option.
But yeah.
Yeah, that's what draw is. Yeah. So for a one drop and for how aggressive and how full of a board Sword can have, I think it's a pretty solid play. But is it a solid option in place of Fangblade Slayer?
They're very different. It's so hard to imagine, right? Because the utility that Mentor's Teachings bring, it might not be as flashy or expensive, but it could be just as valuable, right?
Very true.
It's just a different, it impacts different points of the game.
Mm. Yeah, like right now, Mentor's Teaching, he could put that on the Lancer, trade that into the Grimnir, getting rid of both of the wards. I don't know if that is the optimal play. He still would have a May Leader even after that. Oh, that's what he's going to do.
Oh, and it drew him the second veteran Lancer, so he will remain safe if he chooses to do so.
He'll remain safe, and he'll still have five cards in his hand after that. He's going to put the Lyrial Archer right on turn 3, giving him the option if Potwasher chooses not to trade into it. He can evolve it next turn. Fortunately, Potwasher's going to take that right off the board and not spend a 4-drop at all.
That's a huge tempo loss, as we can see in Potwatch's hand. There's no Orthrus, no Catacomb.
He could have played Dark Conjurer, but I think he wants to save that so it can gain the Summon Ghost effect when you have an evolved ally follower on your side of the field.
Kind of a tough spot. You have two Death Spreads in hand. You have nothing to generate shadows. Mm-hmm. It seems highly unlikely that you'll even get to the point where you can use the Necromancy effect on turn 6. Mm. This might be troublesome for Potwasher.
This could.
The only other caveat is, if Shugo takes the win here, Sword into Blood is going to be a non-factor.
Right. And it could bring the series 1-1. If it plays out that way. But Shugo could win this game.
I mean, in some senses, I could definitely, if Potwasher feels strongly enough about it, there could be a situation where Potwasher says, you know what, I almost want this Swordcraft deck to be a non-factor now. I want him to win this particular matchup so that I can win the next matchup with both my decks.
I can win the next matchup, and I'll still have my Sword deck for a later game. And we'll see if he chooses to do that here. He does have the advantage, I'd say, of being able to play the Cerberus right on turn 5, evolve and trade into the Floral Fencer, and then you've got the massive 5-1 follower and the Coco and Mimi in hand as well for next turn. But he hasn't really been able to build up those Shadow. He didn't draw into anything like a Bone Chimera. So he doesn't have a full effect Death's Breath next turn. He's only going to be able to get the zombies right on turn 6. But either way, right on turn 6, getting those zombies, not the worst thing in the world, especially when there's an Ector in your hand as well. Or he could elect to Goblin Princess and Coco or Mimi on turn 6 as well, still getting a full board and getting more damage as well. But in the hand of Shugo, there is an Albert, a Geno as well. Maybe want to save the Geno for turn 6 to get that enhanced ability. But there are plenty of options that Shugo has to really gain tempo and try to get a board that Potwatcher is going to have to answer into. It's going to be the Albert, possibly evolved on this turn.
There it is. It's going for the 7 damage. It's nothing to laugh at.
Nothing to laugh at all, but this could be real difficult for Potwatcher to deal with. Either an evolved zombie or an evolved goblin princess is not going to be able to take down that massive Albert.
He's probably going to have to spend a Coco or a Mimi.
Probably, I think so. But even then, an evolved zombie, plus that's only 6. That's only 6 attack if he uses one of them. But the Lyrial Archer pinging for that 1 extra damage, bringing that right down to 6. Lyrial Archer, really great play. And you can still play the Dark Conjurer to get that enhanced effect this turn. It's your last Evolve War. That's the last chance you're going to get to really utilize that card.
Looks like he will.
I'm coming for you.
Still, that's a lot of resources that Potwatcher had to spend to get rid of the Albert. He had to spend Coco and an Evolved Lyrial Archer, but all Shugo spent was the Evolve Point on the Albert.
And now all that's left to speak for Potwatcher is the Dark Conjurer. You avoid a lot of damage. God, drawing at that is actually great.
It's really good. There is an Ector as well as Death's Breath for Potwatcher next turn, but I really like the enhanced Geno on this turn. Summoning that immediately, rush, and it still stays alive because the Dark Conjurer won't be able to finish it off, and you get to clear the board, gain tempo, and you don't spin an Evolve War.
Yeah. I like that move in the sense that you play the Geno and you let the Ector trade as the Geno, and then you play the Alvidas for the ward to protect against a turn where the Ector zombies can actually swing.
Right. Right. Very true. So we'll see what Potwatcher chooses to do. He drew into a Soul Conversion. That could be very useful, especially with Goblin Princess in hand, being able to spin Soul Conversion on one of those goblins and get that sweet, sweet card draw.
And the Shadows, too.
Right, yeah, it gives you shadows. 2 shadows for the follower that you destroy and the card itself. So not a bad trade at all. But there is not an Evolve Orb for Potwatcher. Meanwhile, Shugo still has that bit of currency to hang on to try to gain some extra tempo in the later turns with the board that Potwatcher is going to be able to gain this turn, either with Goblin Princess, Ector, or Death's Breath.
I think Potwatcher is trying to be a little bit careful for a scenario where he places Ector into a situation where it just gets removed by something like a Tsubaki, or just gets outplayed just because there's not a lot of shadows or board control for Potwatcher at this point in time. He's not really sure what cards Shugo has in hand.
Very true, very true. Meanwhile, Shugo drew into a Grimnir, and we're on turn 7. This game could very well last for another 3 turns, depending on the decisions the players make, if there's Ector or if there's a Goblin Princess. I'm not wrong in saying that Ector could possibly be coming up before turn 10. I think that's rather obvious. But, I mean, I love the value that this Geno has been able to get.
Luminous? Yep.
Yeah, Luminous Mage. Oh, that's really good. Man, being able to get that board presence, and Geno getting massive value. He's been able to attack twice.
I think this Luminous draw is so important because Evolution Orbs is definitely what Shugo wants to do to stymie this Death's Breath kind of pressure. You need a lot of those resources, right? Against the second Death's Breath, against a kind of big Ector play. Evolution Orbs are so valuable right now. To be able to get one for free is going to be very helpful here.
Very crucial, very crucial. There is
also
the Shadow
is kind
Reaper.
Of a pseudo ward, right? Because you don't really just want to let that Luminous Mage live.
Right.
So it's going to be soaking up at least a attack here.
Yeah, I think this one zombie that doesn't have ward is going to be trading into a Luminous Mage there. Bring into the night, leaving the zombie with ward alive with 1 health. And you still have the Shadow Reaper.
Couldn't play the Shadow Reaper there.
The Shadow
but now
Reaper
we're in
with
a
Goblin
situation.
Princess, yeah.
where we can play. I mean, we've got like this turn 8 play where you play Alvidas plus something. And you got the turn 9 Albert. And you close it out with the turn 10 Grimnir. Very strong.
So you could play Alvidas Veteran Lancer as well, getting massive wards that the Shadow deck has to deal with. This could be the Sword deck running away with the game. He's going to go for face damage here. What's the draw? It's going to be Cerberus. But there's no Evolve Orbs. And even with a Shadow Reaper in his hand, I don't think it's going to be enough. I think with the
Albert
next turn.
In the chamber, right? You need some kind of ward.
Oh my gosh. That's Potwasher bowing out.
There it is. Swordcraft prevails. But this also means that Swordcraft can't fight Blood. So the question is, Shugo's alternate deck, does it beat out Shadow? Does it beat out Blood? Right? If it can't win against both of those, then we're in trouble. Mm-hmm. If we were to assume that, okay, I think eventually Shadowcraft can be successful. And if we were to just look at statistics, right? I know this isn't actually how you would look at it. But if you were to look at statistics, Shadowcraft would probably win this next matchup. Then it would go to alternate deck versus Vengeance Blood.
Right.
And Vengeance Blood is that X factor, right? It's this new deck that's coming in. Well, not necessarily new. It's been around for a while, but it's coming in now into a situation where it's like, where you have to wonder what those interactions are going to be, and it's not as comfortable to play against just because it hasn't been showing up in the Shadowverse Open in a very long time.
Right. Right. Very true. And it's a shame that we've seen the Death's Ledger deck get knocked out. So both of these Shadow decks in this Mirror matchup, it's going to be a mid-range against mid-range. We'll see how the players are able to manage their Shadows, manage that currency being spent to really squeeze out the little advantages that are going to make the biggest difference in this game.
We'll see. Shugo has the opportunity to just close it out right now.
Very true. Very true. With a pretty decent draw from both players, they both have very similar hands. We'll see which one is able to get the advantage. Potwasher's going first. He's got that advantage.
I really favor Potwasher in a sense that you can play the Conjurer into the Bone Chimera, and that gives you a very solid, and you have the option to go Grimnir as well, but that gives you just a very solid option that's tough for Shugo to remove, because even if you try to ping out the Bone Chimera, you still got the two skeletons.
Especially if you're able to draw into something like a Grimnir, for example, or excuse me, a Shadow Reaper or a Grimnir. He does have Grimnir in his hand as an option as well on the next turns, on the next turn.
I think that little advantage, I mean, based on the draws, could turn massive, but it just puts Potwasher in a slightly better position in the mid-game, and he's leading in terms of play points.
Right.
It's going to be important for him to, A, build Shadows, which he can do better with the Bone Chimera. Oh, and he draws into the Ector. He would have liked to draw into that a little bit later, but not too concerning yet, because you still have that choice to play Chimera or Grimnir here, and I think both are good options.
Yeah, Shugo's got the Death's Breath, and Potwasher has the Grimnir. So we'll see how those cards are able to really make a difference in the mid game.
Hit face, and puts him in a situation where maybe Grimnir is going to come out as a response here.
Yeah, that Catacomb's no longer a thing on turn three. Yeah.
Shugo is definitely feeling the effects of being one step behind Potwasher.
Yep, there's a board already established for Potwasher. And Shugo doesn't have anything like a zombie party to deal with the board and the Grimnir and the war that Potwasher is able to put out, so we'll see what Shugo does here to try to climb back in this game. It's a real difficult position position that he's found himself in because of the advantage that Potwasher has of going first. Because now we're seeing that Potwasher's drawing into the options like Cerberus, really cementing his advantage that he's going to have in the mid-game. And he's got a pretty solid turn four if he wants to get rid of two cards in his hand. I think, he might just have to summon the Bone Chimera. Just get that out of your hand. And you save the soul, and you save the Dark Conjurer for when you have an Evolved follower, and you save the little Soul Squasher for when your opponent has an Evolved follower. But there hasn't been much trading, so, I mean, both players are sitting at zero shadows. That could be absolutely crucial, especially for this Phantom Howl that Shugo's got in his hand.
Yeah. And I think this is a situation where, obviously, Shugo's going to be playing out some options on his next turn, and that's when we'll really know. But we know that Potwasher has about 5 shadows on board right now.
Hmm. Right.
He's going to cash in on one of them here.
And we'll see like how much of those shadows really come into effect. I mean, the Soul Squasher, it's going to be difficult for that to really get its full effect. I mean, especially if you don't have those shadows. It's just a 2-drop. But, I mean, Shugo, he might not even put Potwasher in a position where that's even an option. He could play the Literal Archer here, ping the Grimnir for 1, and then go for phase with the Dark Conjurer while trading into the Bone Chimera with the Literal Archer. I think that will be what he wants to do.
Yeah, I think that's a smarter option.
Mm-hmm.
Take the lesser amount of damage here.
Right. Get rid of those followers, trading the Dark Conjurer into the Skeleton. Trying to get the most effect out of that card. And little Soul Squasher, knowing that you're on so few shadows, knowing that even on next turn, if you only got 2 followers, you're not going to be on 4 shadows anyway. So just trying to get that tempo, trying to get another follower on board. But this is a Soul Squasher that Potwasher has if he wants to get rid of that Literal Archer. Evolve it, trade, and then you've got a Dark Conjurer of your own to summon the Ghost to get rid of Shugo's Dark Conjurer. I really like that play. And you save the Cerberus for next turn as well, if you want to Cerberus and then Coco.
Yeah. Getting the Cerberus on the field can be quite nice in the scenario of, like, setting up a lot of pressure or just having that ability to reach far.
Mm-hmm.
But I think Potwasher's kind of effective board clear was a better option in this case.
Right. And there's a Soul Squasher for Shugo, so we could get rid of Potwasher, Soul Squasher, but then you spend your shadows and you don't have the shadows you need for Death's Breath or Phantom Howl.
Potwasher, Soul Squasher.
Potwasher, Soul Squasher. Should be an album name, man.
Sounds like there should be a third line that goes with that.
Mm. Potwasher, Soul Squasher. I don't know. That sounds pretty good to me.
Potwasher, Soul Squasher.
Potwasher, Soul Squasher.
Mm. Nice.
It's not a bad tag.
But Shugo could be looking to do the Soul Squashing in this particular instance. I feel like he's got kind of a not the nicest turn 5.
Hmm.
Right.
Yeah, not the nicest turn 5, especially when you want to be summoning Cerberus and evolving on that turn, and that's going to be all the shadows that Shugo has. He's back to 0, and he spins an Evolve Orb to gain tempo right on that turn with the Evolved Soul Squasher.
Still a zombie party, and if the Cerberus decides to trade into the Soul Squasher, it's still not going to die.
It's going to Soul Conversion the Evolved Soul Squasher.
I think this is very important. You get the Catacomb, but you have no cards on field to take advantage of it. Mm-hmm. Cerberus is going to come down. You don't need to spend an Evolve resource. That's very valuable because you only have one more. And you set up a situation where now Ector is going to come in and be able to buff up at least these 2 cards on board.
Right. Right. Because there is the Death's Breath, so he's not going to be able to get the enhanced effect. Shugo isn't. But you can still evolve and trade into the Cerberus, for example, just to get rid of that. So try to mitigate some of the damage that's going to come out from the Ector next turn.
The enhanced zombie party is actually very strong as well, just because of the amount of shadows that it's going to give you.
Mm. Mm. Very true.
Oh.
And that is the last Evolve Orb for Potwasher spent on the Skeleton to try to get an extra little bit of damage.
That's what happens if, in your life, you drink a lot of milk.
And you get strong bones.
Mm.
Makes sense. I believe it.
Yeah.
He is one big fat skeleton, man. He's been drinking his milk.
He's not fat. He's big boned.
Oh,
delightful. All right. You've got Skull X2. And 6 play points.
Right, something to try to get a little bit more shadows, I think. The Skull Beast and the Catacomb, being able to get more followers, and the Skull Beast has, last words, gained 1 shadow, so he's trying to set up for an Ector play next turn as well, especially destroying his own Soul Chimera, trying to get those options, trying to earn more shadows, which he just did. He's sitting on 6 shadows now, which is great, but now there's an Ector in the hand of Potwasher. He could. I mean,
maybe Zombie Party is the option here, just to get stuff on the board.
Yeah, maybe. try to get more stuff on the board. But when you do that, then Shugo just plays his Death Breath or his Ector next turn as well. I think. Oh, it's going to be Zombie Party.
I actually, like, very agree with this scenario because now if he plays Ector, there's a situation where, you know, you could maybe swing for the kill.
But now Shugo might choose to play a Zombie Party of his own, taking out that Cerberus. And then that is one absolute, and that would be game.
Yeah, you got to clear out the majority of these cards.
Right.
Phantom Howl Mimi will do 7.
This head can't be taken.
All right. 4 cards to 3. I think he might be dead. Because he got 2 damage. +4 is 6. Oh my god, he is 2 health off.
Oh no. Oh, a Goblin Princess. Another way to really fill up your board as well, so he's got the options. The win condition is Ector and then the Mimi as well. And he's still sitting on Phantom.
It's so
Howl.
Interesting because in this scenario, if you had something like a Soul Conversion, you could actually close out the game, right?
Mm.
Swing the Zombie Soul Converted, Phantom Howl, then you Mimi.
Gotcha.
But because that's not the case, the Zombie takes up board space and you can't really suicide it and do phase damage. And so you only get the 2 plus the 4 is a 6 plus the 2 is the 8.
Right.
So you're 1 damage off.
1 damage off, not bad.
It might
though.
Even be worth it to just Ector and, well, if you Ector, it uses up all your shadows.
Bringing Shugo's Ector down to 4 health, so a Zombie with Rush will be able to take it out. That's a lot of shadows spent on 2 zombies that are not really going to do anything this turn. But I don't think he's mad about
health.
That because
I mean,
he's
5 to 20.
Yeah, he's got 20 health. I think he's sitting pretty. He's not upset at all. I don't think that Shugo's really going to be able to come back from this.
Yeah, there's no way for him to build shadows to get wards even.
Yep, he's got 5 shadows. Death's Breath, not really going to be able to get its effect. This is a real difficult spot. I think Potwasher is going to be able to take this and bring the series 1-1.
There it is. Potwasher. And, you know, we kind of identified in the opening moments of the game in terms of the hand you have and the turn advantage as well.
Mm-hmm.
All of that compounds on each other in this Shadowcraft mirror match here. He's looking to try to Zombie Party.
Yep. We'll get the zombies, but now that's still a lot of damage coming out next turn for Potwasher. Might. Yeah, well,
yep.
Yep, he's got the shadows. He's got the shadows.
Yep. Oh,
not
boy.
A bad play from Shugo to try to play out his options. Didn't quite want to tap out, but
he wants his opponent to show him, right?
Yeah. Very true. Very well played from both of them, which means we're going into the 3rd game of the series, and Potwasher is going to bring his blood deck against Shugo's shadow deck.
Mm-hmm.
What an interesting matchup.
Mm-hmm. Blood into shadow, I think that's very different. This is a situation where Bloodcraft isn't as... So the reach for shadow is actually very high as well.
Mm-hmm.
But basically we're looking at a turn kind of 6 scenario where that's really going to kick into high gear, because that's when you can play your Phantom Howl and play the 2 Coco and Mimi as well, right?
Right.
That's where that reach really gets crazy, and then maybe the turn 7 where Ector starts increasing your reach by a significant amount. Turn 6 and 7 are going to be important turns for Potwasher. He's really looking to hit a situation where it's do or die by that time, right? Where Blood can swing lethal in that area.
And Potwasher was able to mulligan up his Belphegor, so he's got that option right out of the gate. Man, I love that card. Such a great card, especially when you're able to get it out right on turn 4. Whether you go first, whether you go second, it's such a strong follower. And we talked about the deck composition, his deck composition, where he was foregoing the Soul Dealer to try to get some other options to play with. But he only had three options to draw Belthagor, and he was able to do that right with the mulligan. So Potwasher is
I think this is very important for Potwasher. That's not terrible.
It's not terrible. He's got the early options to play with. I think in the Shadow matchup, that's not a bad decision. It's pretty good, considering how aggressive that mid-range Shadow can be. So we'll see what the plays are here for Shugo. He's got the one drop and the two drop, and also two zombie parties as well to deal with those followers. That Bloodcraft is going to bring out. The Succubus has got 3 health. It's a perfect target for zombie party. But man, the Spiderweb Imp, such a great
double
card on
razor
turn 2.
Claw too. He's holding 3 damage each in hand.
It's a lot of burst damage.
That could honestly be the one kind of surprise factor that Potwasher has against Shugo.
Having those two cards in your hand so early.
Yes.
And you're really able to burst him down if you can get him down to 6 health like that. Yeah, I like that. It's really good. Very strong. We'll see if Potwasher is able to play, is going to choose to play the Blood Wolf or the Spiderweb Imp on this turn here. I love the ward. It's gonna do 2 damage to himself, but it's gonna be difficult for Soul Squasher and the Skull Beast to trade that out and get it off the field.
Mm-hmm. I think that in some ways the Blood Wolf is more preferable.
Mm-hmm.
You Blood Wolf, and then you can swing for phase. Then you may take more damage to face from Shugo, but that just puts you closer at Vengeance, which you have no Belphegor in hand. Mm. There's not really a good way to guarantee that you'll hit that on turn 4.
Yeah, he mulliganed out the Belphegor. He elected to keep the Succubus and the Razor Claw, so we'll see how that decision affects him.
And to be able to kind of have your opponent do that, so he's going to go for the trade here.
Cam does not want that Soul Squasher to keep on swinging. And now there's not a turn at all that Shugo has. He's just going to have to swing and end his turn.
Still a step behind. Shugo is a turn ahead. Potwasher still has no board to speak of.
Right. No board. Next turn, he could very well have the Spiderweb Imp into the Ambling Wraith. So we'll see how those options can affect the game. I like that on turn 3 because you get the massive ward and you get the 1 damage to face. Just bringing yourself closer to Vengeance, but also bringing your opponent closer to their death as well. But it's got the Succubus as well. That could do the exact same thing. 2 damage right to face.
All right. Zombie party?
You could zombie party or Orthrus.
Orthrus is not the most... I mean, you can Orthrus and swing, but then you're going to take 2 again.
Right.
And again, you do have to wonder, and this was the thing that Aya Senpai was talking about, where doing damage to a Bloodcraft leader to put him at 10 health is like...
Yeah, just doing the job for him.
Yeah, not ideal. And in many ways, like, you're committing cards, for example, like if you zombie party the Succubus, you're committing cards to get yourself to be able to swing into a situation where the Bloodcraft leader wanted to be in the first place, so you're kind of using resources and getting nowhere.
Right. So using the zombie party to clear for tempo, just keeping the Skull Beast, trying to wait until you've got the Evolved Cerberus next turn. Meanwhile, Potwasher is still trying to draw into his options. He's got tons of low-cost cards, so he could possibly empty out his hand this, I mean, not this turn, but in the later turns, if he's not careful, being forced to play too many cards in one turn. See if Potwasher decides to evolve the Ambling Wraith or the Succubus this turn to try to gain some tempo, but either way, it's just going to be answered by the evolved Cerberus. And I think that the tempo is really being set by the Shadow deck here, because of the fact that there's no Belphegor in the hand of Potwasher.
The only thing here for the Shadowcraft deck is there's not a lot of actual shadows being generated.
Right. Yeah, very true. This is going to give him 2 shadows, but... yeah, I mean, still, and there's not a Death's Breath in the hand. So that's like the main card that Shadow has that is really going to be spending those shadows before you get to Ector, for example.
God.
Look at that evolved Ector. Oh, such a good card. And now the evolved Cerberus can trade into the Succubus very well.
The ambling Wraith there is actually pretty good because it'll be able to just swing in and kill the Cerberus. It's concerning that Coco and Mimi are going to be waiting on the sidelines. But again, Shu has actually been really, really screwed in terms of followers.
Hmm. Yeah, very true. It was a difficult play that he had to deal with. But, I mean, Potwasher is also not sitting on the best hand in the game. So both players are having to really try to gain those little advantages with the cards that they've been dealt. It's difficult. It's really difficult.
The health levels are pretty much even. That's the thing, right?
Mm, very true.
And now it is going to be even. You have to play the Imp. He does. Closer and closer and closer to Vengeance. And this might actually be the worst case scenario for Bloodcraft sometimes, because you're just at that point where you don't have Vengeance, but you're the easiest to rush down, right?
Mm. And now Shadowcraft has got a difficult play here. With Zombie Party dealing 3 damage, it's not going to be able to take out the Imp or the Ambling Wraith. I mean, an Evolve Orb on maybe the Skull Beast and the Orthrus, if one of them is evolved. Man, a great play, Skull Beast into Orthrus. And if it hits the Angel of the Word, that's great. If it hits the other one, I mean, you're going to have to evolve the Skull Beast either way.
Oh,
did the Ambling Wraith. Oh, no. But now that's a great target for Mimi. Was going to be able to get that right off the board. Possibly evolve the Skull Beast. Yep, to have the right amount of attack. 5 attack to deal with that Spiderweb Imp.
So he's at 6 play points here. The Air Jammer comes in. Not in Vengeance.
And Razor Claw
would put you into Vengeance, but then you won't have enough for the Air Jammer.
Yep, very true. Or at least, yeah, so playing the Air Jammer.
I think it might just be play the Air Jammer anyways.
Right, because that could evolve, trade into the Skull Beast, and it'd still be left with 1 health. So I like that play, depending on what card that the Air Jammer is able to bring up. Because you could definitely gain tempo with that card. And the Angel of the Word can trade into Orthrus.
Yeah. If the Air Jammer brings up a Blood Wolf, that could be useful.
Very useful. Or a Urius, for example, if there's an Ector coming out next turn. And with 6 shadows, and possibly 9, actually. That's the Ambling Wraith. Oh, no. That's, yep. That's the risk of running that card. It's a great as a 1-drop, but if you don't have it on 1... then then you run the risk of Air Jammer bringing it up, which is exactly what happened there for Potwasher.
Oh, man.
Oh, no.
This game has been interesting, to say the least. I feel like they've gotten just, like, half options the whole game long.
Mm-hmm. Really trying to make do with very untasty soup, as it were. But that's going to be going for face damage right there, I guess. Potwasher thinks Shugo doesn't have the damage to finish him off this turn. Does he?
He has 10 damage in hand.
With no Evolve Orb,
If he plays the Cerberus, he will still get 10.
Mm-hmm. But with the Ector, he's able to get a lot of damage, and he's going to be able to clear off the Angel of the Word and the Air Jammer as well.
The thing is, I'm not entirely convinced. Well, he needs a clear board, you know?
Right. Right.
And Shugo needs to realize that, because 8 health is not a lot to have against Vengeance Blood.
No, but there's no Evolve Orb for Potwasher. Yeah, Ector could be an absolutely massive play.
And depending on the top deck as well, like, definitely clear the board.
Mm-hmm. Knowing that you've still got Cerberus and a Coco in your hand, and another Ector. Absolutely massive. I think Shugo is going to be able to take this.
Yeah, 7 damage to face is going to be massive here.
Oh gosh, absolutely massive.
The top deck needs to be incredible.
Revelation.
Even if it was Revelation, would he live? Yeah. Nope. 2, 3. No. Oh gosh, just short. Just
look at
short.
Both
one
players
damage.
On one health.
My God.
Oh my goodness.
What? And that's such a tragic way to lose. It was literally a matter of it. If you look at the scenario this way, that air jammer pulls a blood wolf. You swing to face with a blood wolf.
Right.
That's
been
it.
The game. Yeah, yeah, depends on. That's why in some of the blood decks we've seen, they completely forego a one drop, ensuring that the only drops that the air jammer can bring up are
even
the
if it was
wolf
a Urius.
Or the Urius.
Yeah. Yeah. Even if it was a Urius.
Sometimes we even see a Galaretto in the Bloodcraft decks. It you summon it with air jammer. If you already have a board, then it prevents your other followers from taking damage from spells just for having that follower on board.
So first semis is done.